Senator Albertini, first of all, thank you very much for giving us this opportunity of the interview. It's a big honor. And could I please ask you to introduce yourself to our audience?
My name is Albertina Soliani. I am a senator of the Italian Republic, and I started my adventure in Myanmar many years ago during a period of suffering in the occasion of a delivery of ashes of a Burma, of a Myanmar friend from India to Burma, and at that time I met Aung San Suu Kyi during this time of house arrest, and since that time we understood each other that we had a common path to follow in terms of friendship, in terms of values, in terms of politics, and since that our friendship and collaboration started.
So before I go any further, can I ask you about your interest in Myanmar and how you started to take interest here?
During my first experience, I was a member of the Parliament of Italy. We were a group of politicians that expressed interest and, let's say, share emotions with the situation in Myanmar. At that time, there was a military regime. We knew that there was a military regime, quite hard in the way of the issue of freedom, of democracy. Our group of politicians were very interested in the issue of democracy and the issue of freedom of people. And so we became very much interested to share views and opinion with Myanmar at that time. And that was the way our interest started. And this was followed for many years up to now, to try to give our contribution to the freedom of people. She read a book of Aung San Suu Kyi, the free from fear, and based on this concept of freedom, she felt very closed in feelings and concepts of politics, and that's why the friendship started.
Mm-hmm. So is there a reason this time for coming?
13 anni fa è cominciata con quella tragedia una storia. Quando le storie importanti
cominciano, interest for Myanmar started from a sad story of a death of a friend, and it started 13 years ago, and since that beginning she realized immediately that a story begins and never ends. That's the meaning of their presence. The friend Giuseppe Malpeli died before the elections. He couldn't see the onset of democracy, but his message is aimed during life remains in the continuation of this path together. He said politics is friendship in the first place. Albertina, during this year, has visited Myanmar many times with many different kind of people, from entrepreneurs to professors to young people, young students. So she promoted many type of activity in many sectors, including including health and agriculture. And the reason why she is here during this mission is because there is a conference on rehabilitation, medical rehabilitation. And so this is one sector that has been cared with the assistance of the university and of academics but also from the institution, medical institution from Italy. So this is the reason why she is here, is because she tries to promote the path of Myanmar towards democracy, towards freedom and economic development.
And I think that takes us naturally into what we want to talk about, which is Rakhine, the other story. So the world has been hearing what we feel is one side of the story. They don't want to hear the other side of the story. They haven't heard about it. And perhaps, you know, the story that needs to be heard by the world, perhaps you can talk about your opinion there.
Albertina has been following the issue of Rakhine from two perspectives, from abroad, from Italy, a country, from the international press news, and from the internal. And she noted a remarkable difference between the narrative in the international public opinion and the situation, the internal situation. And her belief is that from the international communities, international organizations, there should have been a much more cautious and considerate approach in examining the complexity of the situation, and not just reporting a one single-minded version of the facts. So that's what she thinks about the approach, the international approach to a very complex problem.
Yeah, so her international approach is very much about a broad global opinion. So the broad global, what is her broad global opinion with regard to Myanmar? It's actually, I'm talking about the driving forces behind.
The opinion about the issue of Rakhine of Albertina is that there is an oversimplification of the problem. Oversimplification that relates to the a number of issues. She said during the at the time the first taking of power in Myanmar, Aung San Suu Kyi assigned the assigned Kofi Annan the report on Rakhine, and immediately after the report was delivered, then she listed the things to be done to implement the Kofi Annan report. Immediately after, there were attack on the military post, and there was the violent reaction of the army. And this was an action that was not in under the control of the state councillor. And the fact that so the oversimplification related to the fact that after these facts, there was no effort whatsoever from the Western world to understand what was what were the real what was the real power in the hands of the state councillor of the of resolving the issue of Rakhine. They didn't understand what was this effort to internationalize this critical issue that were relating to the Muslim communities. So there was no insight from the foreign commentator, foreign countries, to understand what is the real issue of the human rights. And so this oversimplification was the cause of the of this wrong perception of the issue. The approach of the international community was not to understand what was the what could be the issue of the human rights and what action to undertake to resolve this issue. But they simply identified the Aung San Suu Kyi as the main responsible of the silence, of not taking position against this. And so it was a very superficial type of attitude. And this is not the right approach for international community. So there should be a more positive set of actions to try to resolve the issue. And based on this, she has mentioned the fact that there might be some other interests that might want to keep the Rakhine issue alive in the frame of the conflicts, political conflicts between the main powers, the Islam on one side and China on the other side. She said that the approach of the international community was in a way superficial, was limited to identify a responsible, to indicate as the scapegoat for a situation, but the insight in the attempt to understand what were the reasons of the issue was completely ignored. And there might be the suspect that there is the intention or the willingness to keep the Rakhine issue open, to distract from other points or to somehow to control the process of development of the country.
I tre ministri militari del governo sui confini, sulla difesa e sull'interno. Il mondo.
So is that in the interest of the politics inside, or is it international?
So the Rakhine used to keep a leverage on the development policy of a country, or to somehow to keep a kind of control on the process of development. This is might be one interpretation.
And so, since you started talking about the silence of Aung San Suu Kyi, perhaps we can talk about her silence, because her silence to a lot of people is very loud, very deafening. And a lot of people put words in her mouth and some put interpretation. So it may not be fair to ask you for your interpretation, but would you like to try?
She thinks that the attack on one specific person because of the silence is an attempt to weaken the political strength of the Aung San Suu Kyi, and to use this as a sort of trick to exert a control on the policies of development, on pathway to development of the country. And so there might be, it's suspicious that there is this personal attack on an issue that has been that has seen many actors. And so the reason of the, that's what he thinks, that's what
So it also takes us onto the awards as well, because the opinion of the people in the country is that it is an award given by people from outside the country, and they give it and they take it away. So the people in this country believe that the award from outside is not important. Her biggest award that will come to her is that she is going to be able to fulfill the wishes of her people, which is peace, democracy for the next generation as well.
Sono gesti infantili che fanno parte di una visione molto superficiale della politica. Aung San Suu Kyi non è l'icona.
Bertina thinks that the issue of the withdrawal of the awards is a childish attitude from the West, deriving from the poor understanding of the situation first, but also from the fact that the Western world considered Aung San Suu Kyi as an icon of human rights, but they never considered her political role in that she undertook in support of the democracy of the country and in support of the development of the country. And being a politician, you cannot simply be a kind of icon of one single aspect of life, but you have to consider that being a politician, there is a multitude of tasks and a multitude of relationships that you have to take into account. So it's basically a very immature type of approach that the Western country undertook towards Aung San Suu Kyi. They didn't understand what was her mission in the country.
E non assumesse la responsabilità di fronte al cammino di un popolo e ai destini di un continente come quello asiatico che deve avere un dialogo costruttivo con l'Occidente.
So can we now go back towards the neighboring countries, the neighbors in the region? For example, I think time again Myanmar has shown that they would rather talk to the neighboring country, to Bangladesh, one-on-one, just the two countries with no interference from anywhere. So that's the preference. And also the other regional partners and neighboring countries, they can assist in making the repatriation possible.
Aung San Suu Kyi had a policy of good relationship with the neighbor country. The neighbor country demonstrated support to the efforts of maintaining good relationship. The Western world should facilitate this process. Should make an effort to understand first what the situation, what the regional situations are, and should facilitate this process of resolving this conflicts or this conflictual situations. And it didn't do that. It didn't solve. It didn't take this role in the issue. And the issue of Rakhine is not only Rakhine, but is the issue of coexistence of different ethnic group or different kind of population is common to many countries. And the Rakhine is a paradigm for coexistence, like Myanmar is a paradigm of coexistence of different ethnic group. And so any effort should be made to promote this coexistence and to smooth the difficulties, and not that of enhancing the difficulties in reaching this situation. So I think that Rakhine is emblematic of situations where union and not division is the ultimate aim.
So, do you think Myanmar has made enough efforts for the repatriation?
ha fatto molto il Myanmar per favorire il rimpatrio. Bisogna costruire il percorso anche con gradi, perché si tratta di costruire una convivenza. Ma intanto bisogna partire da un accordo con il Bangladesh che consenta ai musulmani di rientrare. Fino a che non si risolvono questi problemi, i passi sono sempre insufficienti. Io sono certa che il popolo del Myanmar è convinto che ha la responsabilità di affrontare e di risolvere questo problema. Ce l'ha il Myanmar. Perché il problema è qua, ma non da solo, certamente in dialogo con i paesi confinanti. Qui occorre una strategia complessiva, tanto più che noi sappiamo che nelle dinamiche del mondo le sofferenze possono essere anche usate per consolidare strategie di potere. E non c'è dubbio che nel sud-est asiatico, in Asia, si giocano delle partite tra i poteri del mondo. E tuttavia chi ha la passione per l'onestà della politica e per la verità delle cose, chi sente la responsabilità di condurre dei popoli, fa delle azioni concrete, quelle positive, quelle che possono risolvere il problema. Sarebbe molto bello e molto importante che avessero attorno degli amici degli altri paesi, delle altre aree del mondo che condividono questa strategia pacifica di soluzione dei problemi.
Just adopting one single narrative which is not reflecting the actual reality.
Yeah, you talk about the single narratives and I think it also The question is, like you said earlier, the Western world or the media has oversimplified and very superficial of the situation. So what is not left, what is not being mentioned in the media is about the complexity of the internal politics because it's huge. So perhaps we can talk about the internal politics. Yeah. For example, there's peace and reconciliation, the ethnic diversity, the language, the customs, the constitution amendment, the 2020 elections, the relationship between Aung San Suu Kyi and the military, and the transition to democracy. So I don't know, I give you a big list. Maybe you can touch on all or some.
She said that in her opinion, Europe in the past century has undertaken, different countries of Europe have undertaken a complex and difficult pathway to democracy. Since the World War up to these days has been a century-long process of hardship and difficulties and economic development. And so Europe, based on this previous experience, should have understood what are the difficulties of a pathway to democracy. And they should have made a stronger effort to understand what are these difficulties, because they did it, they had it. So, what she doesn't understand, why the European countries or the Western world had this superficial attitude, this narrow-minded understanding of the situation, and created difficulties in the country because they isolated the country from the Western world. It's a lost opportunity for the Western world to facilitate this process and to keep a dialogue open with Myanmar,
because it would have been the premises
to create an open dialogue with other Asian countries, especially with the neighboring country, with China and with India. And so it's a lost opportunity.
C'è ancora tempo.
I think the peace and reconciliation, which is internally within the country and the reconciliation with the ethnic people, the recognition that is required because of history, the language, the customs that is important in the country. And I think somewhere you mentioned that there has been progress. Perhaps you can talk about progress, and maybe this is where we need to look at it more.
The Myanmar is a great nation, it has great opportunities, but the ethnic differences among states at present, with the ongoing conflicts, they are stumbling blocks to improve, to increase the success and the development of the nation. As we said before, with all these diversities of different ethnic groups, with different traditions, different cultures, it's a paradigm for the integration of different elements of a common society. The Republic of Myanmar is a republic of the Union of Myanmar, so union means tying together, making diversity a resource and not a challenge. And if Myanmar succeeds in peace, in reaching peace and reconciliation among the different ethnic groups, it can be an example for the whole world, where this problem, in different ways, they are present in any country. So it's Myanmar is not only an internal problem, but it can be an international example of reconciliation and of union, of taking diversity as a benefit and as a value. Albertina thinks that the priority to obtain a concrete step towards the pacification, is a stopping the seizing the fire, seizing the armed conflict. As she mentioned, the Bible, she said, Isaiah wrote in the Bible that all the weapons have to be turned into shovels and plows
to
stop the killing and stop the conflict, but turn all the energy into building the country. So it's a message of hope for the future that requires as a priority to stop the country, to give a message to the young generation, not to prevent the country to develop and the young generation to have hope for the future.
Si chiude la porta del futuro per il paese, per le nuove generazioni.
Maybe we can turn that into a slogan, from guns to shovels.
So it needs to keep going and going fast in these peace negotiations, in such a way that the effort can be turned from destruction to construction.
But in all this, is not the relationship between Aung San Suu Kyi and the military important?
The relationship between Aung San Suu Kyi and the military dates since a long time. Albertina said that even during the house arrest, Aung San Suu Kyi was not completely prisoner, because she had her internal freedom to take position within the frame of the development of the nation, development of the democracy in the nation, and ultimately she succeeded. And also the military themselves, while allowing this process to develop, this democracy process to develop, they somehow they recognized Aung San Suu Kyi as a resource, as a reference point. And so Albertina thinks that it's a mutual support that they both receive each other, And the military, they should support this pathway to more and more concrete and solid democracy that is embodied by Aung San Suu Kyi. That's the, her opinion about how this sort of conflictual relationship or political relationship should be developing further.
Molto bello.
So Aung San Suu Kyi is the reference point for this process of democratization and should be kept.
You've been in and out of this country many times, and perhaps you can tell the world of what you see about the religious tolerance in this country.
Sei stata in questo paese molte volte. Cosa pensi della tolleranza religiosa in questo paese, in Myanmar?
Sono andata in un quartiere di Yangon e ho visto il tempio indù, la moschea islamica, una chiesa cristiana, la sinagoga ebraica, stesso quartiere, e anche la chiesa armena, che a me è molto cara.
She has been in Yangon and she visited at one time the Hindu temple, the Islamic mosque, Catholic church, even the Hebraic synagogue, and the Buddhist temple, of course, and even the Armenian church, which is very close to Albertina. The fact that she recognized in a single quarter of Yangon all these diverse churches, the diverse representation of different religions means that the tolerance, the community, understand that the tolerance and the issue of living together can be possible. Even Rakhine one time, probably there was peace, there was harmony among different religions, we know from historical times. Some periods, on the other hand, see that the contrast between different religions are stimulated in, as a sort of attempt to establish a predominance of one over the other. And this is not the way. The religions, the use of religions and the tolerance among different faiths should be is a strong driver for peace. So coexistence of different of religious diversity is a strong driver for peace. Tolerance and coexistence should be promoted.
She's been active on the Religious for Peace as well in that grouping. So would you like to talk about some progress there?
She has been promoting and participating to a conference of Religion for Peace recently, where different type of faith of religions were represented, from Baha'i to Buddhist to Hebraic and Muslims. And they talk about methods and pathways to a common coexistence. They saw as a way to a common living for the benefit of everyone. History has created many differences among the different communities because of culture, because of historical events.
So one last question, and yes. I promise you it's the last one. It's, for example, because you come from Italy, what can Italy do, or what can Europe do to help in the process of the transition of this country, for peace of this country?
According to Albertina, there should be a strong political will to undertake action, to promote the dialogue, so to take a constructive position towards bringing the different actors together and promote the dialogue. Albertina informed that in 2020 there will be an event from Religions for Peace, where different faiths will be represented to discuss issue of sharing and coexisting together, with the aim to focus on the situation in Myanmar. So this will be an opportunity to discuss in an open way and in a constructive way of what can be done to participate directly or indirectly to this peace process, peace building process in Myanmar, and contributing somehow to the development. Religion for Peace is a tool for peace building.
So, Senator Albertina, thank you very much for your time. So we hope next time you visit, the situation would be so much improved.
Tendo anch'io di vedere i cambiamenti.